Hi, my name is Sharon Corbett, and my presentation is on social perception. What do you see? Two faces or one vase? You could blink your eyes and you have a totally different perception of what you see or what you think you see. It's only your perception. Social perception, a way we gather information to form an impression of people. We make snap decisions, judgments, which may lead to stereotypes and become bias of people. How do we get this information? We get it by nonverbal behavior, by ways of facial expression, language, eye movements. Did you know that there were six primary emotions? Happy, sad, fear, anger, surprise, and disgust. Not all the time what is displayed is the obvious. And I said that because when I was giving birth to my daughter, I was crying hysterically when they brought her into the room, after I gave birth to her. And I was hysterically crying with joy and happiness. But when the nurse came in, another nurse came in the room and she saw I was crying. She thought something was wrong with me. She thought I was in pain or something was wrong with my daughter. But that was her perception. Because usually if somebody is crying, it's because they're hurt or they're sad. You know, it's something negative. But as you can see how everything you see and hear may not be so. There's also occasions where I laugh if I'm scared, especially on a roller coaster. I don't yell like normal people do. I start laughing, you know, and it's not because there's anything funny about being on a roller coaster, but because I'm scared, that's one of the things that I do. I laugh when I'm scared. Body language. Body language is a way of communication with your body. I'm a co-occurring counselor, and a lot of times I find myself reading my client's body language or gestures. When we have a one-on-one session. For instance, sometimes a client might be sitting there with his arms crossed while we're talking, and to me, it seemed like he's on guard or he's not welcoming my assistance. Or if he's leaning forward towards me, I interpret that as being he's interested in what I'm saying. He's open to suggestions and the help. Eye movement is another element of nonverbal communication. Looking directly at a person could mean that you have their undivided attention and they're open to you. Avoiding eye contact could mean that they're bored or they're not interested in what you're talking about. Self-concept. Self-concept is when individuals perceive we make perceptions of our own behavior and abilities and our characteristics, you know, my perception as myself, I believe I'm a good friend. I'm a kind person, but that's my perception. Now, you might meet me and you might not think that. Okay? And self-perception is something that you do over a lifetime as we continue to learn more about ourselves. One of the things that self-concept consists of is self-esteem. Now, self-esteem, it's an evaluation of a person's positive, it's an evaluation of yourself, you know, very much a lot like self-concept. And we have a positive view of ourselves, which is we call high self-esteem, which means we're confident, we accept ourselves the way we are, we're optimistic, we don't worry about what people think about us. And then you might have low self-esteem, and that's where we view ourselves in a negative manner. We lack confidence. We want to be liked, you know, we want to look like or be like somebody else. Maybe we perceive them as having high self-esteem, and we want to be like them. And we're always worrying about what others might think of us. And we have and people with low self-esteem have a pessimistic attitude, you know, always think something is going to go wrong. Excuse me. I believe that, you know, it goes both ways, that, you know, people have high and low self-esteem. You know, I personally don't know anybody that haven't experienced having low self-esteem, you know. So that's my take on it. Then retrospection. It's what you might do when you analyze your own thoughts and feelings. And there's a lot of ways of doing this. I didn't name all of them, but I did name some of them, like self-perception theory. This is a theory about how you perceive yourself. You observe your own behavior. Like if I said something or did something that I think I might have hurt another person's feelings, you know, I would process it and I would think about why I said or did that, you know, and I probably would go back and apologize to the person. And they might not think that I did anything wrong, but this is my self-perception, you know, that my observation on my actions. Okay. And then we have social comparison theory, where we compare ourselves to others based on their social and personal worth. An example of that might be, I might feel like I don't measure up to my coworkers. You know, they have bachelor's degrees. So it would drive me to make improvements, improve my abilities and maybe go back to school for my master's, you know. But that's by me comparing. But that's not a true story. That's not why I returned to school for my master's. Okay, but that's just an example of the social comparison theory. And then you have the downward social comparison, right? Where you're comparing yourself to individuals who are inferior or less fortunate than yourself in some kind of way. And I find this with my clients also. They might say something like, well, they compare themselves with another client and say, well, I have family and he doesn't have family members. You know, he doesn't have people coming up to and making drop-offs for him, you know, but I do, you know. And I think in some kind of way, they say it's a downward comparison, but I think it sounds more like they are building themselves up to off of some at the expense of somebody else's misfortune. And self-handicapping, individuals, they sabotage themselves in preventing themselves to moving forward. They sabotage themselves. Again, I'm using an example with my clients. I see this all the time where they might not, it's a dual diagnose program. Really, it's a tri-diagnose program. It's criminal behavior, it's criminal, mental, and substance abuse. And in one way or another, they might sabotage themselves, right, as not following the rules and regulations. You know, they don't want to say, I'm not ready to stop using, you know. But they'll might do something against the rules and regulations of the program, which will force staff members to ask them to lead the program. You know, so that's like they're sabotaging themselves. And so it won't look like it's them and the reason why they got kicked out. You know, the reason why they will relapse once they leave the program is because we kicked them out, you know. So to me, that's what self-handicapping is. Then you have bask in reflected glory. And this is individuals who associate themselves with well-known, successful people and to increase their self-esteem. And I work in Philadelphia, PA. And I never seen nothing like it. I'm from New York originally, born and raised. And when I moved here to Philadelphia, I never seen anything like it as far as Philadelphians supporting their sport teams. And they will, instead of saying, oh, the Eagles won the Super Bowl, they use the terminology, we won, as if they made the accomplishment themselves, you know. So that's what basking in reflected glory means. You know, you bask in somebody else's fame and accomplishment. Then we, last but not least, we come to culture and self-concept. And this is the self-concept is heavily influenced by culture factors, in particularly society, community, and ethnic groups. I found that North Americans and Europeans have an individualistic view of themselves, whereas Asians and Africans and Latin Americans have a more of a collective view of themselves. And again, I'm gonna use my clients as an example, okay? I've been in this field for, I wanna say maybe, you know, a little over 15 years, okay? And I have found that when it comes to criminal activity, drug and alcohol activity, right, that certain ethnic groups They don't see it as, okay, I'm gonna do it this way. North Americans and Europeans, okay, if somebody in their family committed a crime and they went to jail, right, they tend to just see it as the individual. The individual got in trouble, and they will support them. They will send money to the jail, for them to put on their books. They will visit them, whether they did the crime, whether they was innocent or not. Whereas Asians and Africans and Latin Americans, right, they're more collective, as a as an ethnic group. And if somebody in their family went to jail, right, it would be shameful for the whole entire family. The whole entire family would be embarrassed as if each person has actually committed the crime, right? And they do not support them. They will cut them off because they are so shameful because they badmouth, they left a bad taste in the community about this family, And this goes both ways. If a member of the family became a doctor, it's like the whole family is a doctor, Like everybody, I find that in both, that they praise them if you're doing good in both collective and individualistic communities. That's with both. But when it comes to something negative, it's totally different. So, end of my presentation. And my biblical verse is from Romans chapter 2, verse 1. You therefore have no excuse, you who pass judgment on someone, for at whatever point you judge another, you are condemning yourself, because you who pass judgment do the same things. And my two questions are, number one, have you ever passed judgment on an individual when you first met? What was the judgment and what was it based on? What does the Bible say about judging others? Question number two, based on our readings about self-perception and self-esteem, what does it mean when someone says they are living true to themselves or being the best person they can be? Please explain this in terms of what we have read. I'm just giving you a little time to read. What I just what read what's on the screen. Thank you for allowing me to present this to you, and thank you for your time.